Well, now, gentlemen, I do believe that we should be reviewing Pikachu. Have you heard of the Pokemon?
Pokemon.
And if you've got the young Pikachu fanatic in the house that has been dying to talk to this little yellow celebrity, is just the ticket.
Really thrilled that you made it in. We think you're great. Your stuff's great. We love your review. We think that you've got the good.
GeekCities.com/info.
To hit with my voice while I'm still sick, introducing Night Attack.
Night Attack. Bringing you the best of the worst of the internet. Ever since I got sick from what I assume was a devil bug riding on the shoulder of one JRY from OAK. What's up?
Oh yeah, no, it was me. Not your you. Three children.
No,
sure. Yeah.
No, listen, they all swore it wasn't them, and I believe them. You call my daughters liars?
Yeah. What are they gonna do? Fight me.
All right. Listen. Oh my god, no. I got so sick, man. We were supposed to record, like, first of all, traveling back in time, how great was last Tuesday night?
It was really a very uniquely awesome thing because, you know, at some point when you're doing, and listen, there's a lot of people in this audience that do podcasts themselves, right? And podcasting in general is a very lonely pursuit. It's a lot of you by yourself talking into your mic and hopefully having somebody either across from you or on Skype that you talk to or doing it by yourself. But very rarely do you get to have those kinds of moments where you're like, you walk into a radio studio or you walk on a television set or something. And those always feel special. Last week felt like if somebody else was just walking in, aside from the fact that the studio is like in your house, right? Like, that's a radio studio where we had a guest and we had a long form conversation. It was amazing.
Yeah, man. Also, he definitely smoked three joints in this room. That was amazing.
That dude was Thomas the Tank Engine. Choo, choo, choo. He was puffing away.
I was like, wow. Yeah.
Okay, so by the way, can we journey into Bonnie's mind? Because that got kind of sprung on you, right? That was
a... All right, let's break it down. Because let's... Bonnie, how would you describe the conversation leading up to and warning of the fact that Adam Curry was going to smoke three joints in studio?
It was kind of like, brace yourself, honey. Here it comes.
Like, it's happening. It's here happening. It comes.
Now, before anybody makes any assumptions, you guys recently not only have soundproofed the studio, you have the rubber stripping at the bottom of the door, and you have a circulation system that specifically is for heat normally, not like dank.
Yeah,
chronic
yeah not last week though. No, it was great.
There was heat in this room. You guys had some energy. Am I right?
Yeah. What's funny is people
ladies.
Are all like, people are all like, you know, how was the contact high or, you know, and all that. But there's good circulation in here. I think.
No, yeah. I mean, I think that's what people need to understand is like this, like what you have is for all intents and purposes, like it is a radio studio.
It has
radio studio circulation.
Right. And in fact, even the door itself is an indoor-outdoor door so that it again, originally to block sound. But it's like you walk in here, you're in a different world and you're totally cut off from the rest of the house.
Especially since when you walk out of the room, you don't smell anything. And then when you walk in it, it smells like Gary Johnson was studying Aleppo.
By the way, separate from everything, I got on a weird site. I ended up, God, I'm such an asshole who is that asshole who retweets his own things to tell a story. Last night, somebody was like I don't know what got into me. I was just like there was an article saying about how George Bush Sr. was going to vote for Hillary. And I was, and my point was, hey, so that's decided, right? Like, she's definitely the president. If she's definitely the president, literally nothing matters. And in that case, why don't we do something nutty and allow like a third party to take the mic or whatever? And then of course, you know, the first response was, he doesn't even know what Aleppo is. And this is me being an asshole. this guy says, Justin, he says, sorry, buddy, that he's truly clueless and he's trying to steal votes. And I said, define steal? And he goes, well, the man had no clue what Aleppo was. How is he qualified for anything? Just out there to take votes from Trump. And I said, question, do you actually know what the army does with a light energized penetration ordnance? And he responds, no, sir. And then I say, WTF, how am I even supposed to take you seriously when you don't even know what the meaning of A-L-E-P-O is? Because I'm an asshole.
You're such a nerd.
I'm a nerd asshole. asshole.
Oh my God.
Who was watching First Contact last night and apparently experiencing a delayed contact high from when.
All right, hold on. Let's get this entire conversation. Let's get a straw poll going. Is Brian a nerd, an asshole, a nerd asshole, or Pol Pot?
Or let's, dad, let's dad, get, dad. Somebody says dad. Can I just be a dad, please?
Is dad just short for nerd asshole?
Like, if you're like yes, all of the above.
Dad, from the Latin root nerd asshole.
And what's funny, and of course the guy didn't get it, and somebody said like, oh,
no. You know, he didn't just like surrender his sword to you and say, ha-ha, bested in verbal combat by among the best. I swear fealty to you now, Brian Brushwood on the internet.
He actually did after I spelled out the joke. And then he said, oh, you got me. That was a good one. And I was like, oh, God damn it. I'm a terrible person who has dumb ideas that nobody should ever believe ever.
No, sometimes you just want to get into it, man. You want to mix it up. You want to throw a brick through the other guy's windshield. Get it going.
Brian,
dude, I'm going to grab this beer.
I have a confession.
What?
Uh-oh.
Okay. Do y'all want to hear
about you Billy Bombay Billy?
Oh, my God.
You're the Justin in question.
Okay. So I go to Sonic today.
Uh-oh.
Right.
And you know it's about to get loud.
I know.
So, like, we go to Sonic, and, like, this is, like, a little treat for Penny. She did really well getting a shot, and she's really got shot phobic. Like, she freaks out, and she didn't today. And I was like, okay, so at the end of the day, we'll go get you Sonic slush. Okay, awesome. And so we stop off on the way home, and it's pretty late. Like, play practice is late, and so I'm stopping off at a late time, like going, okay, it's 7:30 and we're usually wrapping things up.
Sure.
Well, we place our order and nobody is like coming with our stuff, but then meanwhile Penny's pretty jazzed and we're talking about everything, and so we're talking, I'm like, oh man, I'm gonna have to push that button again, aren't I?
You're gonna push your second button pusher?
I have to. We have not gotten our drinks.
Wait, how long? How long is the wait?
It was at least 10 minutes for three drinks, like three slushes. How easy is that?
Mm.
Right? 10 minutes? And nobody was there.
That's like, listen, that's like, I can understand a second button push.
Yeah. I mean, it was at least that, and I think probably
more.
Well,
and also, I'm assuming the second button push wasn't to say, this is an abomination.
No!
Like, I assume you were going to say, hey, are my drinks coming?
Yeah, and I'm just like, oh, you know, we had those drinks, and he was just like, oh, they're on their way, and I'm like, great, okay, so whatever. And then, meanwhile, I'm already feeling kind of bad because, like, what if they're over there? They're like over there leaving the button on. Like, do they listen to your conversation? Because meanwhile, like, maybe they're delaying our drinks because the whole time I'm like just trashing their menu. I'm like telling Penny, I'm like, this is terrible food. The American diet is so bad. And I'm like, are they like listening to me? I go, what do you think, Penny? She goes, I feel bad too because I'm totally agreeing with you. Like, this is really bad. And I'm like, yeah, well, oh well. I mean, and I go, well, let's say something positive. And she goes, kids sure like it. You know?
So wait a minute. This is you recognizing that maybe your drinks are being falsely delayed, and you encouraging your daughter to put on a play wherein you guys approve of.
Well, and like
Sonic.
Also, like, how are you communicating to Penny? Are you on like Signal and you're like sending end-to-end encryption?
Also, like in my imagination, you're writing down a note. You're like, I really disapprove of your homework performance, and you hold it up and it says, say something nice about the Sonic menu.
Right. No, I mean, we're having this whole dissection in front of, like, if they're eavesdropping, which they shouldn't have been, like, I'm assuming I'm going
well,
on
they're
this.
Not. All right. No, number one, that's a ridiculous notion, right?
Right. No,
by the way, I love the fact that you're already forgiving them and you're like, I'm willing to accept their apology when it comes.
Apparently bodies crack the prism program of the Sonics nationwide, where they're warrantless wiretapping into every single pull-up car.
This isn't the part that I was trying to get to.
Go for it.
So the girl, and then the girl comes over, and she is just like a moon face. She is like innocent, and like she is just like, oh, hello, I'm young.
Is that the way when you worked at fast food as a kid, you would show up, you go,
what can I do for you?
She's just I'm so excited.
Would you like to supersize that?
Here's my ID and birthday. It totally was. It was just like she had this air. Like she was just so like, I'm here and I'm serving it in this grate. And then she brought her food. And so she gives me like,
you have read such a backstory into this person who you had a 2-second relationship with.
Yeah. Okay.
By the way, Justin, can I just request?
I am the promise that exists in the world. Oh.
If I could, I would love to kickstart something called the Digital Parrot. And it's a mount you put on your shoulder, and you attach an iPhone on it, and it allows Justin Robert Young to be FaceTiming at all times. And then that way, every time I have this conversation, you can be the voice of reason on my shoulder.
Oh, so much better. So she comes over, and like I saw her talking, like she was sitting down and visiting with somebody, and then she got up and skipped off to work. So like there's like other context going in, right? So, and then she brings us our drinks, and I was like, she's like, oh, sorry for the wait. I'm like, oh, no problem.
I'm sorry.
And
what then, you mean to say is she is like,
exactly. So she comes over and she hands me my drink.
Oh, I was born after 9/11.
Totally, she was.
I've never known what dial-up meant. I don't know the musical recording artist Nelly.
So she hands me my drink, she hands me Penny's drink, and then she hands me something with like all this like stuff on it. And it was just slushes, and I said, oh, what's this? And she says, it's this cream. You wanted an orange creamsicle. And I said, oh, no, I'm sorry. No, I ordered an orange slush. And meanwhile, I don't even know if they wrote it out. Like, I was probably an asshole because they probably showed it on the screen and I didn't see it.
You didn't look, yeah.
And I didn't look. So yeah. I was already feeling
so
pretty bad.
That's why she said, oh, you should have checked the order before you hit confirm.
Well, maybe he did or maybe he didn't. But he read it back to me. And I was like, yeah, that's what it is. But then she brought this out, and I said, oh. And she goes, oh, that's okay. You don't need to worry about the price difference. You can just have it, you know. And then she hands it to me. I said, no, wait. It has ice cream in it, and don't y'all have peanut warnings? Like, is this peanut-free? And then she says, no, it's not. Like, there is peanut warnings with our ice cream. And I said, and then she hands it to me. And I go, no, I'm sorry. My daughter has food allergies to peanuts, so we cannot have that. And she goes,
man,
it's not a big deal. No, you can have it. And then she hands it back to me. I said, I'm not going to take a drink that's going to kill my child.
Time out. This is the intro to the new MC Allergy diss track. Fuck you, Sonic. Where's my chronic?
I think Brian's going to sing it to us. Oh, yeah. I'm dropping the beat.
This is an MCA joint.
Oh, no. Oh, no. You can't believe that it's here. Listen here, Sonic lady. You think you got youth on your side? Well, guess what?
Time out. Pause.
The allergy brings death.
Pause. Pause the music. Pause everything. We need a real expert. Let's get a real expert in here. If we're going to write the Sonic diss track, I want somebody who knows exactly how to drop amazing rhymes under a beat. I want none other than super famous, incredible actor extraordinaire. I want Romany Malco to join us, ladies and gentlemen.
He's not here. He can't be here.
No, you say his name three times. Here, Romany okay. Malco. Romany okay. Malco.
Romany Malco.
Romany Malco.
See?
Oh! Oh! All right, Romany Malco. How are you, buddy?
What up, people?
Dude, all right, Romany, I don't know if you saw right before you called in, but Bonnie was in the middle of a harrowing tale of trying to go to Sonic with our daughter who has severe food allergies to peanuts, and them knowing that their creamsicles have ice cream with peanuts in it and accidentally bringing one out, and they're trying to give one to Bonnie, and we're trying to think of how would a Sonic diss track over the serious subject of food allergies to peanuts go. And you called at exactly this minute. You telling me that's not serendipity?
Well, it might be, man. It might be. Let me see here. I'd be like, you know what I'm saying? First of all, we don't want your motherfucking peanuts. Take your whole employees and staff and you can get on these nuts.
Keep going.
Here we go.
Keep going. Keep going.
Because you got to remember, there's a kid that's present. So you got to kind of keep it clean, right?
Yeah, sure.
So, you know what I'm saying? Y'all about to witness a murder up in Sonic Burger. Whoops, that's not clean either.
Oh, my God. Well, I'll tell you what, Bonnie, can you at least try to give us the MC Allergy refrain? Fuck your motherfucking peanuts. You can get out all up on these nuts.
Oh, man.
Yeah, Bonnie. Right, right, boy, Bonnie. Right. Here you go. Ready? 3, 2, 1, and.
I don't think. Okay.
Come on.
3, 2, 1.
You got it.
Fuck your mother. Fuck your nuts.
Motherfucking peanuts. Why don't you get up on these nuts?
Fuck your mother. Fuck your parents. Why don't do that?
It's fuck your motherfucking peanuts.
Fuck your motherfucking peanuts. Why don't you get up on these nuts? I don't have nuts.
All right, Romany, I'm not going to lie. I know Justin well enough to know that we're angling. We got a magic maker in the audience who's gonna actually make this a song. If you can just give us two more verses, I think we got a whole song here.
Two more verses.
Oh my God.
I mean, single lines. I don't
stanzas.
Care. Stanzas. Stanzas. I don't know.
Wait, is a stanza just a line?
I think it's just a rhyming one rhyming couplet, and then he can stretch that out for a good 30 seconds.
Ought to smack that popsicle out of your hand, looking like a freak with candy in a minivan.
There we go.
So much better than me.
There we go. Well, now, Bonnie, I'll tell you, don't sell yourself short. I feel like, you know, toe to toe. This is great. This is the best of both worlds.
Romany Malco, how have you been, my man?
Man, I've been good. Good to see you, Brian. Justin, what's up, my brother? Loving
the
bit.
Yeah, man. How you doing, dude?
Man, you know what? I've been living in Puerto Rico for the last year and some change, and it's good for my health. But as far as like reliable internet and stuff like that, not so
good.
Dude,
well, apparently the internet gods are smiling upon us. Did you go native when you went down to shoot Mad Dogs?
Yeah, I went down in 2014, saw what it was about, and was like, I've been already looking for a place to live in the Caribbean, and I just never thought of Puerto Rico. And when I got here, I was like, oh, wow, it's close to home. Everything that I love to do, you know, so I'm all about getting in the water. I'm all about nature. I like, you know, I love fishing and all that other stuff. So hiking.
Yeah, you talked to me. You told me the story of when you moved out to L.A. and about how, you know, kind of zen you got and how you were out on the beach when you got your first big break. Am I remembering the story right?
Exactly. And this is kind of like, so that's basically it. Like, I mean, it's weird and crazy and extremely philosophical, but I always feel like whenever things get stagnant, it's actually time to stop. where most people try to busy themselves, I got to do what I got to do, I actually find time to stop. And when I say stop, I'll take 2-3 weeks, sometimes a year, on just on the beach and away. And I mean, of course, a year is a luxury, but I remember I was losing my house. I straight up was losing my house. My business was falling apart. I had $973 to my name. And I was like, well, sell the house. Let's get out of here. And I spent every single day, every single hour of every single day pretty much on the beach. I came home only to sleep. And that was when my big break started rolling in. And my theory behind why things worked out that way is because, you know, if you think of your life, your mind, your brain like furniture, right? You can fill that house with a lot of like cheap furniture that isn't very functional. And then you run out of space, or you can take time to clear out that space. And, you know, if you think of your thoughts like furniture, you can have a lot of dysfunctional and counterproductive furniture in your house. And if you think of your – did you guys disappear? Because I'm not
no, 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 no. We're, no, no. Sorry, no, we're cutting
the,
over to
switching
you.
Switching the shot there.
Yeah, I think of my thoughts. Sometimes I look at the negative things happening in my life and I begin to clutter my brain with these negative thoughts, and I kind of create like this negative inertia. And so when I take a beat, I get to the beach and or I just get away from everything outside of that immediate environment, it kind of clears things up. Oh, man, I'm fucking this all up.
No, you're doing great. As a matter of fact.
We're going to talk to Romany. Romany's got a huge, amazing project coming up. Of course, the Tijuana Jackson movie that is crowdfunding right now. We're going to get into every single inch of that. But let's just do our really quick Patreon plug. Patreon.com/Night Attack is where we can continue to bring you shows like this. Man, we got Adam Curry last week. We got Romany Malco this week. Next week, we got Tom Merritt. But just don't tell him. Just make him seem like he's as important as everybody else. it is your help that allows us to do this very show. So please go ahead and thank you to everybody, all the new support after the Adam Curry episode. And we look forward to continue to bringing you the most amazing content we possibly can. Again, that is patreon.com/nightattack.
Yeah, man. Thanks to all you guys. all right. So you finished Mad Dogs, and you decide to stay there, but now you're pimping your new project, Tijuana Jackson, the movie.
Yes, yeah. So what really happened was I finished Mad Dogs, then I had to come back to the States to work on a movie called Almost Christmas. And I really didn't want to do it because I was so exhausted, but it ended up being probably one of the best things I've ever done in my life.
Well, that's awesome. And
then, yeah, it is awesome. And then I just grabbed my stuff and got my dog and headed back to Puerto Rico. And, you know, just ultimately, man, just wanted to take a more entrepreneurial stance in my career. And so moving to Puerto Rico was a step in that direction. And also, look, I don't like jumping. You know, how many times have you like, you live in LA, you gotta get up, walk your dog early, feed your dog early, you gotta shower, rush to get in traffic for 45 minutes to go sit down and have a 20-minute lunch, right?
Yeah,
about
sure.
Bullshit. Now all that squash in 15 minutes on the phone while I'm walking on the beach. You know, dude, what I'm saying? And just LA tends to like guilt trip you and suck you in. You gotta come to my dog's funeral. Oh my God. You know, and I'm like, you know what? I like being outside of that. I'm not Mr. Networker. I don't, you know, anyway. So
you are an element of that is the fact that you have a name, you've got a track record, you've got a very visible brand. Anybody knows that they're going to cast Romany in a movie, they know what they're going to get. That you have high energy. You're gonna play the parts that you played before. You're gonna elevate whatever is there material wise. So you can do that, but you had to lay those seeds in LA to kind of get that moving a little bit, because otherwise no one's going to call you on the beach for 15 minutes, right?
Well, you know, you're right. But, let me, it's so funny that you say that, because I remember the very first job I ever booked was a Tim Robbins play, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Tim Robbins from, you know, Shawshank Redemption.
Yeah.
And it was a play. And I didn't know I booked it, and I got on a plane and flew to Italy with my girlfriend at the time. And at the time I couldn't afford the trip, so she actually paid for the trip. I ended up having to pay her back. And while I was there, my agent called me and she said, you know, well, so I checked my messages, I heard her, so I called her and said, yo, check this out. I'm in Italy. And she cursed me out and went off, you know, so irresponsible, blah, blah. It's the first job I'd ever booked. And then she called back and left a message saying, call her back. So I called her back and she was like, you know what? I'm wrong. I see so many people in this business put their lives aside and sit by the phone. She goes, you live your life because that's what you're going to bring to your jobs. And you know what? I kind of live by that. And even though I've had this acting career that, you know, has built gradually, I pretty much spent a lot of my time living in Paris, living in London, living in the Slovak Republic, living, you know, abroad.
How long was that Slovak Republic sojourn? How long were you chilling in the Slovak Republic?
Like 6.5 months, 7 months, you know? It was, listen, I like made friends there, like real, real friends. And
yeah.
it's just hard to leave, bro. It's hard to leave.
I mean, I'll tell you what, at those prices too, depending on when you were there, man, like you can live cheap out there.
Really could, man. You really could. I forgot, was it crowns? They spend crowns there. And it was like, I don't know, 35 crowns to a dollar or some shit like
oh,
that.
Oh, yeah. No, I had friends that would even go to Prague and would just be like, man, you can, like, especially compared to, like, Paris and London and stuff like that, man, you can stretch a $10 bill so far to wrap around your head.
Yo, let me tell you something. It's true. Let me tell y'all really quick. If you want to see, like, if you want to see women that look like sketch art, women look like somebody sketchy.
So super sketchy women. Go on.
Go to Prague. Go. No.
Oh, sorry. No, that's not what you meant. I'm sorry.
Just perfect physiques and beautiful, tall. And listen, you need to go to Prague. That's all.
Yeah, and I would assume in the you know, you're in New York, you're in LA, probably even London. The category of super charismatic, handsome black guy. A little more competitive than in the Slovak Republic, right? Like yeah. you're gonna stand out.
Believe it or not, my buddy, his name's Freddie Asai. He's like a really big pop star there, and he was a brother, and that rule definitely worked for him. But when you're walking with Freddie, you're basically walking in Freddie's shadow. I don't care what side of you stand on, you're walking in Freddie's shadow. You know,
you were orbiting another more famous, charismatic, handsome black guy.
Trying to find my way. What the, you know, I kept crossing the street. He'd be like, what are you doing, Romany? I'm being like, just want to spread it out a little bit.
So one more question before we, you know, move over to your new big project, which I'm super, super excited about. How did you, and I suspect I know the answer to this before I even ask the question, but it's like, there is something very, very seductive about the whole way that Los Angeles and Hollywood runs, because you're constantly, because of the reason you mentioned, which is like, you're always being asked to be at little events and you always feel like you're climbing up a ladder, and constantly every day you wake up, you're like, oh, today I get to go meet, Gilbert Gottfried's bicyclist. He has a bicyclist, and so
I like it to watch this producer's balls.
Yes, exactly, right.
And Shepard.
It's very seductive. It feels like you're doing something, but ultimately, I think you cracked the code, which is like, you know what does something is focusing on what truly matters. How did you divorce yourself, or more importantly, how did you keep yourself from being seduced by that nonsense, fake reality of there being a ladder to crime? To climb? To climb.
No. You know what? That's a great question. I say, I'm going to start by saying that I never really bought into the carrot.
Yeah.
You know, I came from music. And so I've kind of always seen, music taught me that self-generators pretty much rule the world, especially in entertainment. So I was like, you know what? I got to be a self-generator. And when I came into this business where people were trying to sell you the carrot, what I learned quickly was, the minute that I did 40 Year Old Virgin, people were inviting me this shit because it upped the, you know, the stock and marquee of
right.
Of
you being fame. There held value for them, right?
Exactly. And so I was like, oh, I see what this is. And they want to include you in all these projects that you just weren't really inspired by. And being that I never really bought into it, it wasn't that difficult to be like, okay, let me detach from it. But what really happened was, I was at the Optimum Health Institute doing a nice wheatgrass enema. I'm kidding.
Oh, thank you. Shit almost got real weird between us.
and real grassy.
And there's a stimulation in heaven. No, but
everybody in the chat, apparently, we all had the same doe-eyed stare for like 5 seconds there.
Exactly.
Oh, no. But no, half the people in there, just because Romany's got great stories, half the people are like, oh, wait, for real? Okay. Yeah. I guess Romany's into it.
But the funny thing was, I really was there doing stuff like that. But there's a class that we do where we have meditation, and it literally crossed my mind. And I want y'all to really chat realm. By the way, I'm not 47, I'm 48, and I want y'all – oh, you're right, I am 47. I'll be 48 in November. Okay, so I want y'all to hear this little story real quick because I think it's important. What I did was I was sitting in this meditation, and after the meditation, it kind of crossed my mind. I was like, wow, you know what? I really thought that after 40-year-old virgin that I was going to be like – the go-to brother for any time you needed a cool black dude in the movie, right?
Yeah.
And can't front, I did get a lot of those calls, but when I looked at the material, I wasn't – Judd would always say, you got to be careful not to take junk because you end up back in the rat race. And that was great advice. And it kind of gave me license to take my time and choose. But the point that I'm making is that it didn't turn out. I didn't become that Hollywood – name that I thought I would have, you know, that I was going to become, partly because of me being so selective and for whatever other reasons there were. But the point is, I thought to myself, well, maybe I've peaked financially. Maybe I've peaked professionally. Hell, maybe I've peaked socially as well. And I was like, well, considering where I come from, this isn't really that bad. So why not we just go and enjoy this shit? And that was pretty much within 3 weeks I was living in New York, and within 4 years of that I was living in Puerto Rico.
This guy right here.
Yeah. Woo!
All right, well, here, part of the reason why I'm going to extrapolate that you were being choosy and you are being a self-generator, as you mentioned, you create – this is how we crossed paths initially, was the Tijuana Jackson character. I think you had done something for Funny or Die initially, that you'd come up with a character
Justin,
and then...
Stop, Justin, stop.
Go.
That's what you call a segue, people. That's what you call a segue. Chat room. Acknowledge greatness.
Let's go.
Pass that man his crown. Oh, by the way... We got any of these in there? We got any of this?
What's that? Oh, no. This. Yeah. There it is.
Flip your hand. Yeah, no, you have an opposite there. So you're touching the pads of your fingers.
That's right. There you go. Perfect. We got it. You got it. You got it. Yeah. Looking good.
This feels dirty.
I know. This is all like Justin.
Well, also, this is legitimately the American Sign Language word for pussy, too. So, like, so you had it dirtier initially.
You're right. You're absolutely right. Okay.
So walk us through. I didn't know the Diamond Club symbol could get any dirtier.
For the audio listeners, what you are missing is that Romany is now licking his fingertips so he can make the Diamond Club sign.
You know what? I'm down with that. That's the complete ritual, I think. I think if you really mean it, like, it's one thing to flash it, but like if you establish eye contact, I'm looking right at you, Romany. Ready?
Yeah.
That's real.
That's real. Yeah. That's real.
That's how you get it to.
That could be beef in the chat realm right there.
That is. Oh yeah. Oh no. It's on there at that point.
So
maybe you got to smooth down an eyebrow, like.
Ooh. I'm liking this.
So walk us through.
Great theater of the mind here for everybody listening on audio.
Man, Bonnie is getting physically aroused. She's having a hard time seeing this.
I'm just laughing because I've been watching the chat, and like half the chat room is saying, he's mine, he's mine. And then I'm wondering, like, what are they talking about now?
Hey, listen, man, all you got to do is head down Puerto Rico way.
Yo, he said, I'm aroused. That's hilarious. I got to get in there. Let me get in there. Okay.
So, all right, here. So do that while you talk to us about how Tijuana Jackson initially came up.
How Tijuana Jackson, the way that Tijuana Jackson initially came up, you mean the movie or the actual character?
The character.
The character. The first
because
time that you
understand
came
for
up
those
character
guys,
and how did you bring it to any kind in front of any kind of camera?
Right, and just to clarify for new listeners, man, what, 3-4 years ago, we were reaching out to anyone and everyone who would consider being on our show, and you made our list, our hit list, and then it was a PR agent that reached out to us saying, like, he'll do it. but he wants to do it in character. And we're like, we don't know what the character is, but we'll do the entire hour in character. That's fine. And what followed was one of the most remarkable hours I've ever been privileged to take part of. Tijuana Jackson showed up on NSFW's show and was a domineering personality who took over the entire show, and nobody was pre-informed. Nobody knew it was coming. We never broke. The entire hour long, we were only doing an interview with Tijuana Jackson, and it was utterly remarkable.
Wait, yo, best, probably the best Tijuana Jackson interview of all time. In fact, it's undisputable. It's the best Tijuana Jackson. That was
this guy.
Rock.
This guy.
Good Lord.
It was.
No, hey, everybody, please stop, because that's how you suck up to the host. Come on. Here we go. That is how you suck up to the host.
The double hug finger salutes.
All right. So where does it come from initially?
It comes from initially, believe it or not, I saw a Hughes Brothers film called American Pimp.
Oh yeah,
oh, yeah.
Gotcha.
As a matter of fact, we have friends. Some people watch the Double Toasted podcast, and they did a American Pokemon Pimp. But I had no idea that was the same source material.
I was about to say, I thought you'd like, we have friends that were in that film. I was like, shit. Okay, but yeah, man, I saw that and it was like culture shock, because, you know, I'd seen pimps and stuff growing up, but I'd never really indulged in that world. And when I really got to see that world in that way, I thought it was hilarious that these gentlemen had these interesting philosophies to justify what they were doing, right?
Juxtaposed.
You have not seen American Pimp. Hold on, wait. Can we just indulge talking about American Pimp
Let's do this, man. You want to start it off? I'm going to just tell
I'll tell you what. Real quick, see if you can find just a segment of their anywhere in there. I'm ashamed to admit that I haven't seen the original movie itself. I only saw the Double Toasted American Pokemon Pimp.
Oh no! It is great. So it's a documentary, right? It's not even a movie, right? This is a documentary, and it is like, this is not this isn't a Snoop Dogg video. Like, this is like the real like Player's Ball, right? Which like happens in some hotel, ballroom. It's like this bizarre prom situation where it's like all these people.
Well, American Pimp really tracks the lives, though, of all of these different pimps and the way in which they manage their brand.
Yes, exactly. Right?
And it does eventually, there is a part where they do get to some kind of pimp function, but predominantly it's just following the lives of pimps and their hoes.
Yes, and this is not a glorification. Like, if this is, you get a real look at who the kind of people are that decide to be pimps, and what goes in to the day in, day out, from you wake up in the morning to you go to sleep, life of an actual pimp.
Exactly. That right there is Rosebud, and Rosebud's talking about how he became a pimp and how he was such a square, but he would talk all that shit because he had a brother who was really, like a real player pimp. And so he would talk like that, and this girl that really liked him would be like, hey, I'll work for you. And it was just like a Friday night, right? Prime time for pimping. But he was such a square and didn't know anything about it. He was like trying to be cool. He's like, bitch, you a pimp for me? You gonna hoe for me? I tell you what, be ready Monday morning. This ain't a fucking tech job. This is pimping.
Exactly.
That's the story.
There's prime time.
Exactly. She was ready to go. And so this movie kind of showed you the rise and demise of these pimps, but I was really fascinated with the philosophies that they had created for themselves, within the world that they were in, within their world to justify their actions, and the ways in which you could see these people with very damaged self-esteems and very skewed perceptions of reality, kept this, helped to sustain this world that they were in. And it made me take it one step further. And I was like, some of these guys are like aspiring life coaches. Only thing is that they are life coaches to these hookers, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
And that I got to be real, that all of them don't really, I just say that I've seen sharper knives in the drawer myself.
Sure.
Right. And then, but it also Tijuana, but it also inspired something in me from the fact that I have family that I've grown up around that would give the craziest advice. Like literally my dad told me when I was dating the love of my life, I was a little kid, 17 years old, dating my first girlfriend. You know what my dad told me? He was like, cheat first because they do it.
Wow!
Right? So some of the worst advice, you know, I'd gotten, was from people that I loved. And I thought it's really interesting if you were with someone who had the best of intentions and kind of gave advice in a way that was, you know, like it's nothing, like TJ always says, there's nothing worse than a broke motherfucker trying to lend advice.
Sure, and, sure.
You know, so anyway, the long and short of it is that taking flawed people with the best intentions, and TJ is the epitome of a flawed person with great intentions.
So I have a question about TJ's backstory, but I want to give Bryce.
Oh, Doctor just came into the realm. I got to say what up.
Here we go.
Oh, Doctor, of course he's there. In fact, he can call in anytime. I don't know what line. I guess we'll open up a line. Also, Bryce, as long as I'm throwing side quests at you, Bryce just gave me this look, the
like,
shrug
he's
emoji.
Like, I'm going to throw something to you, but also here's another thing.
Yeah, also, listen, let's get a little further into the interview, because if Odakta comes on, it'll just be Odakta and Romany talking, and we ain't going to word it edgewise.
Good point. I was actually hoping that we could maybe find just a taste of that first time that we ever met Romany as Tijuana Jackson. But the question I had is there, do you ever say what crime Tijuana Jackson committed? Like we know.
I know it by memory.
Oh, really?
Yeah, no, he got arrested for what, stealing gas from a school bus?
Exactly. It was really like just a misdemeanor.
Well done.
Escalated to a felony because he was smoking a cigarette, which endangered the lives of the kids that were still on the short bus.
Yeah, for the record, that's a bullshit charge. He should not have gone down that way.
Well, no, but that, I'll tell you what, it's so funny. It is so funny that you got that from American Pimp, because that was, I mean, that and like Hustle and Flow, which came out probably within like 5 years of each other, like both took those elements of like, that there is a little Tony Robbins to the pimp profession, right? Like, and hey, no, I'm making you money, I'm making you rich, and that's why you're going to do these things that society demonizes and is literally illegal and is going to put you at risk, right? And so
go ahead.
Well, please. No, yeah, I mean, so when it comes to Tijuana Jackson, like there is obviously an element of you that is TJ, because you are somebody that's very introspective, that does want to help people, that does often give advice. I mean, listen, you were living that bit. You had your cell phone number out there where people could call Tijuana Jackson any old day of the week, right?
Dude, even better than that, Romany, like as I'm listening to him, now keep in mind, I'm somebody who quit his day job and went deep into all of the self-help stuff, all of the sales materials and all that stuff. So I'm hearing advice from Tijuana Jackson. I'm like, that's Brian Tracy. That's Tony Robbins. That's
so
like,
true.
I'm like, I know exactly where this stuff came from.
Exactly. I went and got as many DVDs. They were like self-help DVDs. I got as many books as I can. And I would just sit in my basement and just absorb them all. And I'd take the quotes and then I just turn the quotes into something else. I'd be like, oh, okay, I'm going to make this quote into something different. And I don't know, man, to be honest with you, I sincerely believe that Tijuana Jackson is just the unapologetic version of me. Now, I'm going to talk about race for a minute, but it's also a lot to do about culture. And ultimately, when you live in Texas, you know, as a young black man in the 80s, right, you subconsciously become apologetic for your blackness. So I was already an overcompensator. I was really overcompensating to make people comfortable and to make people, you know, like me, because you pretty much walked into the room and were labeled immediately, you know? And so
And by the way, that's not like from any nefarious design. It's just the fact that like there's so few. Like I grew up in Katy, Texas, west of Houston. There was exactly one black kid in the entire school, and they had to explain what racism was because we didn't have race. We had one guy.
Which by the way, does not mean that racism doesn't exist.
Oh yeah, like, no. It just totally means
you have not run into the rocks that create racial tension yet. Because that was one of those things where, like, I grew up in South Florida, a very diverse place, right? You know, every high school I went to was like 50% black, 25% black, 25% Hispanic, 50% white, right? So there was at least a larger representation. Then I went up north, where apparently, oh, racism doesn't exist. Oh, you people in the South, you're all the racists down there. And it's like, nope, you just haven't run into black people. Because when that spills out, oh, Jesus, that is like the worst, you know, kind of like, you know, bile you've ever seen in your life. When some kid from Maine who doesn't know that Jews doesn't have horns has to actually have that conversation with somebody. Real conversation.
Dude, I've experienced that level of like ignorance, for lack of the word, just, you know, lack of awareness. And coming from a West Indian family, we had traveled. So believe it or not, we experienced equal racism from blacks, you know, in the United States living in Texas. But I was just basically saying that to say that I kind of became, a people pleaser.
Yeah.
And, you know, and an overcompensator. And, you know, at some point I had to do some soul searching to kind of get to a clearer idea of what actually makes me happy. And so Tijuana Jackson is, you know, an amalgamation of all these things that we're talking about. And I forgot where I was going, but, you know.
We were talking about the origins of this character.
Yeah.
And what I'm going to guess where you're going is that that element of somebody that is stereotypical is the wrong word, but like just proudly an amalgamation of black America is an element of you that you weren't able to express.
Exactly. You are on point, dude. It was like
this guy right here.
Apologetic.
That's two for Justin, one for Romany, none for this guy. Go ahead. Keep going.
You know what? I should hit you off with the intro because the intro was so damn sweet. Matter of fact, hey, chat room.
All right. That's one for chat room, one for Justin, two for Romany, zero. I don't know. Forget it.
No, but that's what it was. Is that it's just going to sound so weird, but I was apologetically black. I would almost like apologize for my presence living in Texas because it made people uncomfortable or they looked at you weird. And so I think that Tijuana Jackson was therapy for me in becoming unapologetic for being born the way that I was born, you know?
Sure, yeah, sure.
And so in this weird way, it was as much as he was helping other people, he was helping himself the most.
So you invent the character. Where is... And again, we're very, very flattered that you think that ours is the definitive interview. But where was the first time you ever debuted the character?
I started doing the character in 2000 when the film came out. I record myself everywhere I went. 7 years later, I'm going through some old tapes. I find this footage, can't stop laughing. This dude's riding around in the car, sees a squirrel, and he's like, I like that. Remind me when I'm in. Made me feel like I'm in the wilderness, you know? And I was just like, this is ridiculous. So I started putting little clips up on MySpace.
Yes!
There we go.
MySpace.
Because by the way, you were like, listen, this Friendster thing is dying. Like, I got to get on the future.
Exactly. I'd never even done Friends. I just heard about it. I wonder if Justin's interested in selling MySpace. No, I'm kidding. Honestly. Yeah.
I know. So, I think he's out of it. I think it's already on to, yeah, there's some Chinese company probably owns it.
I don't know. Okay. Real quick. Can we take a trip down memory lane and see our first encounter with Tijuana Jackson? And unfortunately, this is before we started displaying the chat room, because what you don't get to see is the reaction of everybody in the chat kind of saying, like, nobody, not one person realized it was Romany Malco from the 40-Year-Old Virgin. Everybody is just like, what is happening?
Probably because nobody wanted to make that guess and be wrong and be the racist in chat.
Is that the black guy from that one show?
And, you know, and how many kids do you aspire to have? And, you know, a lot of people cannot answer these questions because they're not being specific in their desires, okay? What do you want? Do you want someone who watches Fox TV, okay? Or a buffoon? You have to be specific.
Yeah, indeed. All right, well, you want to know what? Let's get right into the questions here,
Oh, my God, just look at the production value. Holy smokes, jeez.
I have a Canadian girlfriend. He says, parenthetically, yes, I'm an 80s rom-com archetype. No, you haven't met her. Due to health problems, I cannot move to Canada ever. Should I move to the border or let her find somebody more accessible?
Okay. So let me just make sure I understand this. Because of health problems, you cannot move to Canada.
He cannot move to Canada. No. He apparently has a health condition that prevents him from going north of the border.
Well, the first thing I'm going to say is you shouldn't be dating nobody unless they're in quarantine with you, okay?
He broke under the first question. That's amazing.
To really have any kind of relationship.
All right.
No, to answer your question, honestly, I think one of the things I'd like to say is, first of all, you have to understand that you already know the answer to the question. I'm just helping you to bring the answer out, okay? Listen,
so, by the way, this is what I love about Tijuana Jackson, is that you started with the bit, and then you cracked yourself up, and then when out of moves, your first move is to actually give good advice, because you're somebody. Yes. No, it was great. It was an amazing hour. It's up on the NSFW show backup channel. Just go to Diamond Club and ask around. You'll find it.
Yo, Slow Joe said he thinks that was his question.
That's great.
Slow Joe, real quick, just let me know. I'm in the room. Just let me know. How are things? How's your health these days?
We'll see. He'll respond as soon as he has passed.
We're gonna see, and if he doesn't answer, I'm gonna shave my beard so I look like a young Greg Giraldo again.
I swear to God, you guys haven't changed, and I was about to say, I bet you if you shave that beard, you look the same, the freaking same.
Yes,
I probably listen. I'll tell you what, the fact that I look like a failing stand up comedian or Stoner Aladdin, as they said in the chat room, and Brian looks like video game cosplay.
Oh shit, that's so funny. Go back to that video really quick, man. Go back. Oh, dude. I don't know why your hair makes me think of Eric Estrada.
Yeah. Oh, no. I've definitely got that 80s, that feathered kind of look there. Like, that's definitely a thing. Let's get back to Tijuana Jackson, the movie.
Which we've only mentioned for the first time just now. This is the reason you're on the show, is because you are taking Tijuana Jackson to the big screen.
Absolutely. And, you know, before we go any further, I have to really credit you. That particular interview built an instant following for Tijuana Jackson on YouTube of, like, I don't know, 55,000, like, right out of the gate. And I don't know what happened. Somehow that video just started getting views, and people just started subscribing to the channel. So, which you encouraged me. You actually had me. We sat down in Houston's in Redondo Beach, and you kind of gave me the rundown of what needed to happen next. And I began, you know, slowly but surely putting the episodes together. And as you can see, they evolved. And Tijuana Jackson's following, you know, became a real thing where TJ ended up in the New York Times, and I ended up doing stuff for HBO. And I really attribute a lot of that to you guys, man. You know,
no, wait a minute. No. You had done Funny or Die before you were on our show, I think. Really? No?
We introduced him to the internet. We said, hi, they're insane. Enjoy.
Well, I thought I could have sworn to God that you had done that before that. That was crazy. That's crazy then.
Yeah, no. You guys, you know what? And someone just said, what, you know, they want to know if Chatrealm brings 55,000 followers. I could be wrong about that.
No. Because shut up. Stop talking.
No, yeah, it's no, 55 no. million
Hollywood
followers.
Mega actor Romany Malco like says chat realm is the greatest.
That's fine.
Yeah. I think it was closer to that number. I don't know how it happened.
Stop talking. Let's take a look at the preview for Tijuana Jackson's movie.
Okay, can I go to the restroom?
Yes, go. Get out of here.
Okay. Go. We're gonna watch a preview.
Conrad from Weeds.
Woo!
We couldn't afford professional help. Look, I'm an actor, okay? Mostly known for comedic roles. 40-year-old virgin, I was the black guy in that. Baby Mama, I was the black guy in that. Weeds, I was the black guy in that. Mad Dogs, I was the black guy in that. Las Vegas, I was the young black guy in that. What up to Morgan Freeman? Think like a man. I was the whitest black guy in that. But some of you, and I stress some of you, know me from my alter ego, Tijuana Jackson, ex-convict turned motivational speaker. TJ is what I refer to as the street rendition of Oprah. Like if Oprah had some Suge Knight in her.
We see Tijuana Jackson in his cell. This is amazing.
My name is Tijuana Jackson. Life coach with a goon hair from Hollywood, Florida. He's funny, he's insightful, and he values his family above all else. I look for squares. Need some squares. Sisyphus. Hey, Sisyphus!
That's what we call
him. Sisyphus, because he won't wipe the side chick, but he'll ruin his family for one. That's like holding your baptism in Flint, Michigan. God ain't coming. Spoiler alert, God ain't coming.
TJ is based on a lot of people that I grew up around.
My mama had this saying, better to be loved by a few than beaten to death with a sock full of coins. Real shit.
I've interviewed celebrities as TJ. I've done music videos, short films. I even streamed an online show that ended up in the New York Times because people thought that TJ was a real life coach.
Most damaged people you ever meet is in politics, prison, and yoga.
Here's a true story. My team received a phone call from a certain program, and for copyright purposes, let's call it the Pori Movich Show, okay? They wanted to feature TJ in one of their up-and-coming episodes. Now, my manager's assistant didn't understand the call because they weren't asking for me, they were asking for TJ. So she goes, you mean Romany Malco, who plays TJ, right? Silence. All you can hear from the phone and computer keys. And then you hear, we apologize for the mix-up. Thank you very much for your time. Jail or no jail, me and my family stick together like the thighs on pressure. Hurtin'. The movie is called Prison Logic. It's a comedy that tracks the life of an ex-convict just about to get out of jail, set on becoming a life coach and world-renowned motivational speaker.
Everybody think they got haters, okay? But if your hater make less than $20,000 a year, is he a hater or a Haitian?
At times, it is heartbreaking to watch. At other times, it is so wrong and ridiculously funny, but there are instances where TJ is deeply profound.
Life, man. Life is like a vending machine. You know, it's just full of change. Have you got a cell phone? Can I use it?
TJ is my passion project, and I don't want to hand TJ over to a studio who could censor or water down his message for the sake of appealing to a broader audience.
I do a little spoken word, too. Get you sprung on that. Put a sponge on that. They call me Boomerang Dick because I come on backs.
Would you be willing to help me make TJ's story?
Now, I don't need nothing out this jail. They be putting saltpeter in your food, make your wang stay soft. This way, if an inmate rape you, you can't rape him back. You like top ramen?
Look, I know it's bold, but I'm asking my fans, especially my Weeds fans, to dig through your ashtrays and give us your Munchies money.
What if I told you that the reason you get to live up to your full potential is because of one moment? One moment has reduced you to a nigga wanting a champagne lifestyle, Bud Light pockets. You heard me?
I feel like I've been writing this script my whole life. I'm ready. The problem is we need permits. We need hairdressers. I don't need a hairdresser, but my cast of actors do. We need transportation. We need insurance. We need food and other basic necessities to make this film possible. The amount that we're asking for is $170,000. With the skill and technology that my team brings, we can make a pretty touching and hilarious mockumentary with this budget. And if we exceed our goal, we're then given the opportunity to incorporate bigger named actors, bigger set pieces, and we get to provide clean drinking water to our extras. Every single person who contributes will receive one of these.
It's a Rebel Executive All Access Pass. This card contains a unique code that gives you access to our live feed of behind-the-scenes footage, auditions included. So just like an executive producer, you get to keep an eye on the project you help finance. Now, there are many other cool perks. For instance, speaking roles, life coaching sessions with TJ. You can have a live screening party at your house with TJ. You can be TJ's cellmate for a day. You can even get an IMDb credit as an executive producer. But none of this is possible unless we meet our goal. What good is $1 million to a slave if he can't buy his own freedom? In order to meet our goal, we need Rebel executives like yourself, so please go through our perks, see what appeals to you, and contribute whatever you can. Tijuana Jackson's Prison Logic, coming as soon as you say so, because you are the boss. When I get out, I won't be like stripper glitter, because I'm rubbing off on everybody. And I deserve my
dude, that was a great all right,
so here,
pitch.
Wait, before we get in, before we even deserve to get into talking to Romany more about everything about the TJ movie, let's get a prisonlogic.com is where you can get to that page, right?
Right, right.
Everybody, tweet right now. Right now. This is the one thing that we can do. Doesn't cost you anything. Fund it if you can. But if you are listening to this right now, prisonlogic.com. Tweet it right now. I'm going to tweet it right now. And to cover for that, I'm going to ask Romany, how long did you take filming that video?
Yeah, dude, it's nice.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it. We spent like, it was like a 12-hour day, you know, maybe even like a 14-hour day, because we got up there about 7 and left about 9. Yeah. So like started like 7 in the morning and left about 9, 10 o'clock at night after cleanup and everything. And the thing is that I mapped everything out. I had, you know, a bunch of drawings and copies that I'd ran. I found pictures on the internet that kind of gave you the angles that I wanted in the room. I had gone to the studio earlier and took pictures in advance. And then I just made storyboards of everything so that, you know, sometimes you're talking and you think you're on the same page. But one mistake that I've noticed with a lot of directors is that by not doing that preparation, people are really not on the same page, and it can prolong the process, and that just makes for an unhappy crew. So sure, I was overprepared, basically.
So you launched it how long ago? Like a week or two?
Yeah, I launched it on the 13th. So it's been...
Oh, my God. So 1 week in, you're already halfway there? That's amazing. So
And
by the way, not to discount the fact that you definitely need the money and everybody should overfund this so we can make it the most amazing version it can possibly be. But... Mm-hmm. What a remarkable world we live in where it's like what we already saw was movie quality footage. And you're saying, yeah, we could do that, an entire movie, for 1/10 the cost of a low budget movie 5 years ago.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's so huge, is that like you're not like every other, those little elements of sound effects, those, you know, the little tracking shot. It's like, hey, no. Give me the money. I'm not going to waste it. I'm not just going to shoot it on my iPhone because, like, you've got a sense of it. This is the product you're going to get.
No, exactly, man. I really get a lot out of, like, working with the people who are undiscovered. It just – which is why you see the perks at prisonlogic.com. It's like speaking roles, featured extra, you know. I think that there's an internship available there. Is because I really do get off, personal assistant job got bought up quick, but I get off to working with the people who, you know, who are not discovered. And so we've actually put together a group of what I consider budding talent, and they're up on the technology, they know what they're doing, they're accustomed to working for smaller budgets, they're hungry, and that's just the perfect marriage for me. And yes, a big part of the excitement is being able to, you know, take advantage of the technology that's available to us. But also, it's just being willing to, like, take a departure from the traditional brainwashing in Hollywood, you know, kind of imposes on you that if it doesn't come within the certain budget and it doesn't come within, you know, these certain parameters, it's not fit for Hollywood. When you, the three of us have spent a lot of time earning a living off of content.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Direct from the people consuming it. Yeah. Well, and man.
Yeah, who knows? Hey, you know, maybe you can make the money without having to go through another system. Who knows? Yeah. Maybe it's 2016.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's funny, too, because ultimately when it really boils down to it, you know, aspiring to theatrical distribution is, you know, a fairly big deal.
Sure.
But it crossed my mind the other day, especially now that I'm doing this crowdfunder, that another way that we as independent filmmakers can fund our material or monetize our material is to put auctions of your service in the movie. So whether you come to the end of the movie or whatever it is, but you let, oh my God, you guys.
Are you getting buzzed? Dude.
Contributions from the chat realm.
That's amazing.
Oh, shit.
Congratulations, man. In fact, the only reason I'm not contributing is because we're doing the show.
Because we're doing this interview literally right now.
Yo, I'm telling you right now, if I start crying, I'm not cutting off the fucking camera. Okay?
Better not. You better not. All right.
Fair enough.
Where are you going to shoot the movie?
I'm going to shoot the movie. Wait a minute. Let me just say thank you, guys. I really, man. Give me a second.
Whoa!
You said you were going to cut it off, you liar!
Who made Romany cry?
Wow. Okay. I don't know, man. It's this weird thing where it's like somebody comes and donates $2,000. I start crying. Somebody donates $5, I cry more. I can't even. I don't even know how to. I don't. Anyway, it's just. You gotta
all right,
know.
I'll tell you what. We're gonna give you a little bit of time, real quick. It's just me and Justin. You're out of the picture for a moment. Go ahead. There you go.
Hey, listen, Brian. Let me tell you a story.
All right. No, hold on. Can I talk about my poop?
Sure.
What? Yeah. Okay. No, I pooped and. It was pretty. I'm literally trying to think of anything night attack.
Okay, let me tell you this story.
Go ahead.
So for whatever reason, on YouTube, you know, you get fed things that you watch a lot.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So for whatever reason, the two things that apparently appeal to me the most,
yeah,
are wrestling related videos.
Makes sense.
Right?
Yep.
And interviews from a New York City hip hop morning show called The Breakfast Club. Right?
All right. Right on.
So one of these days, I see an interview with Romany Malco.
Oh, sure, sure. Like, no, he
I
makes
know
rounds.
Romany. I love Romany. Let me watch this video with Romany Malco on The Breakfast Club. Now, The Breakfast Club does a great job. They do great interviews. It's solid stuff. But I'll tell you this. Ain't none of that interview had Romany Malco crying on camera.
In your face, Breakfast Sorry. Club. In your face, Breakfast Club. You all right, bud?
I'm good.
All right. Dude, you're not good. You're the best.
Thanks, man.
All right, listen. So, okay, so what is the projected schedule for this bad boy?
Okay, so the campaign ends in another, I want to say like 26, 27 days. And then we begin filming December 1st. And we filmed for 16 days, and we're filming all the exterior in Florida and all of the interior in Los Angeles, California. And the reason is because, you know, TJ being from Hollywood, Florida, there's just a unique aesthetic about that area that you can't fake.
Yeah,
and,
sure.
But unfortunately, I've had a really hard time getting cooperation from the film commission in Florida, like, or just getting people to call me back about locations and stuff like that. And my producers have the majority of their connections in Los Angeles, and we just feel more secure about mm-hmm. handling those types, you know, that type of stuff there, where when if we're relying on daylight, hey, it's okay if all we have to get is a permit, you know what I mean?
Right,
or when
yeah.
we're relying on a crew to really set up and grips and whatnot to set up the lighting and everything, it's imperative that we are secure in that way. So that's the deal. The other part of it is that I want to tell you guys about the story.
Yeah,
Before we get into that, let me just let you know, if you're looking for an exterior extra, do you know who is a graduate from Hollywood Hills Elementary in Hollywood, Florida?
Dude, I tell you what. Listen, here.
I'm just saying, you need somebody like looking at a Sun Sentinel. I will fly down to be a part of the Tijuana Jackson movie.
Dude, we will. Where are you right now?
I'm in Oakland.
Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. None Florida of your business. It's none.
We'll talk. Hey, we'll talk. Don't worry about it.
No, dude, I'm telling you right now, I'm going to, boy, here's my thing. Let me just start by saying, again, I like working with unknowns because my brand of entertainment, I believe my brand of entertainment is you're going to feel like you're watching a documentary. And if you've got celebrity faces popping onto the screen, it takes you out of it. Yeah. No, I don't believe that drama and comedy, you know, are separate. I believe they're one and the same. I actually end up laughing in some of the most dramatic situations. And so there's this incredible merge of all these things that I believe is going to make this feel extremely real, but I'm going to use real people.
Well, this is the seduction of Tijuana Jackson. And it even happened when we did our first interview with you. Oh, yeah. There were brief moments that I was able to forget that you're Romany Malco and that all of this is an hour-long improv bit. And I get seduced. And then all of a sudden you're talking about, you know, ripping off the beard of some Islam, some Muslim. I was just sorry. Stop talking.
But let me jump in really quick and say that another Brian in the chat realm said that Justin could play the UE bomber.
Accurate.
I'm just saying. I got range, baby. I got range. This beard tells tales.
I know you do, bro.
I can play the scared person in the background.
No, you know, guys, we really got to sit down and talk about this because
we'll figure it out.
We will. It's a really heartfelt story about an ex-convict who's getting out of jail and he's finally found his life purpose. He's set on becoming a life coach and motivational speaker.
And by the way,
constantly running into, you know, the stipulations of his parole. He's got to get a 9-to-5. He's got to do all these different like urinalysis and whatnot. But then he's also got his family who needs him at home. And he has a nephew who is fatherless. So him trying to balance through all of these things and make things happen for himself and the frustration he deals with and how he overcomes it, I'm telling y'all, I think I wrote a pretty good real-life heartfelt story that anyone can relate to.
Well, here's the brilliant thing is that you wrote this character, and I assume you wrote all of his best bits in situations like when we first met you, by submitting yourself to the grueling, knives of improv, of improv. Yeah. And out of that comes stuff that you discover the best phrases that make stuff work. So in many ways, this reminds me of oftentimes, like in the 90s or in the 80s, you would have a stand-up comedian who had worked on a lot of material for a long time, and they would figure out a vehicle where that person could give up all their best material. And then, and that's essentially what you're doing, and I mean that in the best possible way. You have not written this as an abstract idea of what you think is funny or practical or poignant or any of those things, but instead, Tijuana Jackson. Yeah, you created the character. You submitted yourself to being in those situations and telling those stories and manufacturing this backstory, which means that what is going to be in this movie will be the culmination of how many years now? A half decade of you being this guy?
It's been more,
It's been 16 years of Tijuana Jackson. I never forget when I did go to Funny or Die, the guy that runs it, his name is, I believe it's Steele, Andrew Steele. He was like, this is the best thing we've ever done. he's like, you know this character like the best of them. It's the best thing we've ever done. It was a very flattering thing coming from the guy, you know, that runs Funny or Die.
I would have to imagine that on top of that, not only do you have the character totally figured out, not only do you have the best bits already called and written into the scripts, which I assume will be highly improvisational, but on top of all of that, you are going to have the freedom to know that you have no studio to answer for. There's only one boss that you have, and it's 16,000 bosses who individually have given you some pocket jingle to make this happen.
Exactly. In fact, I want to tell you something about my process, and I've actually tried to encourage comedians to do it, but the comedians say that they need a live audience. But, you know, the way that I come up with a lot of stuff is it's just thinking throughout the day and rolling camera on myself. Mm-hmm. And then I take the things that I think are good, and then I use them when I do the act. I write them into the actual show. Remember how I would do the Prison Logic show every week?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
And then I'd have this chat room here. So consider this the second tier of testing here, right? Yeah. And I'd have this chat room here and you'd see what people really responded to. And then those became the nuggets that you saved. I never forget the day I was talking about how TJ was saying when I was 8 years old, my uncle tried to put his finger in my asshole while I was asleep with our county. Took about 7 hours of surgery, get my foot out his fucking larynx. To this day, when that motherfucker talk, I fucked his throat up good. To this day, when he talk, he sound like, what's the name of the big old buff dude that won the Grammy? The big strong nigga with the raspy voice from back in the 90s used to work out. You know, Luther what's the name Rose? Of the big hefty dude with the afro? Macy Gray, sound like that nigga. Macy Gray! I knew after the reaction in the chat realm, I was like, that's a joke that stays with TJ.
Yeah.
So, you know, in my opinion, you know, I did an improv movie with Paul Rudd called The Chateau. And we improvised the whole movie. And then after it was all edited and put together, a guy from Warner Brothers came to us and said, listen, I know you guys made that movie for like, you know, a couple $100,000. I'll give you $30 million to make that into a real movie. And we were like, oh, you know, we were all into our art. And the director was like, oh, but the magic's already there. But what I learned from that experience was, and we didn't do it, but what I learned is that's my workshop. That first movie that we shot should have been interpreted as a workshop, and we should have went ahead and made a real movie, you know? And not that the Chateau isn't good. It's actually a great, you know, Paul Rudd's amazing in that movie, and it's actually one of my favorite Paul Rudd roles, to be honest with you. But that's the mentality that I take into the work. So a lot of times when people think I'm improvising, no, I'm just overprepared.
Okay, number one, Romany, you just like Paul Rudd because apparently you both got those Dorian Gray paintings where either of you age. You're just part of whatever vampire cabal that keeps you looking 25. One more question about the movie, and then we can I know people are chomping at the bit. They need us to even up the racial odds here and bring on Odakta. But one more question before we let it go wherever it goes.
Hollywood vampire cult. Mitsula said Hollywood vampire cult. That shit's funny. I'm sorry. Go ahead. All right.
Prison Logic. What other kinds of movies would people be able to compare this to, or are you envisioning? Like what is the tone of the movie? What is it similar to other films that people could compare it to?
If you've ever seen a movie called American Movie, pretty much on the nose. Now, American Movie is a documentary.
Yeah.
Coven.
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 That right there is a huge. I mean, if you think about it, he's a TJ in himself. He is TJ.
Oh my God! If you have not seen American Movie, is amazing because especially in the late '90s, when this is like at the height of Robert Rodriguez and Quentin Tarantino and Miramax, and now all of a sudden, like you could shoot a film. And then it would be in theaters in four months, like it was gigantic. And these are two guys from Wisconsin, right, that are shooting a horror film that is spelled C-O-V-N, but they are insistent is COVID. It is a like Stranger Brew or a Strange Brew, a Second City sketch that is amazing.
It is, honestly speaking, one of my favorite movies of all time. I have like a few movies that I like. Like I live by, one of them is One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. More modern, I like City of God. You know, I can go down the list or whatever, but that movie really stood out to me. And I've probably watched, the only movie I've ever watched as much as that movie is One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. And so the only other reference I have is kind of like, you know, it's a bit of it has a Borat-esque feel to it, you know?
Sure.
Quite frank, even when I was sitting and shooting the pitch video, I was just kind of surprised at the tone and the richness and like the little things that I wanted to do, for the imagery. And I'm like, you know, it's hard to compare it to anything because I wanted a bit of a movie feel, right? With, you know, but mockumentary style. You get what I'm saying?
Sure.
And I don't know where I've actually seen that, because I think that, you know, the rules of movie making, I think sometimes when you're trying to make a mockumentary, you try to stay away from that. But something in my gut tells me that's right for TJ, because the dramatic lighting plays into TJ's over the top, bigger than life personality, right? But the way that he's talking and the way that he's moving lends to, you know, that very documentary-esque style, whatever. Anyway,
right.
Blah, blah, blah.
All right, well, I'll tell you what. Why don't we do this? Let's bring in our official racial liaison. One, Owen J.J. Stone, a.k.a. O-Doctor, is going to be coming up shortly.
Here's all I need to say. The fact that American movie is the part of the DNA of prison logic has me so excited. Go watch American movie immediately.
You really should. I don't know if I've ever watched a movie more than I've watched that. And also, it's just like I got to tell you, it's interesting, because you're looking at a guy who is a life coach to himself and to the people around him.
Yes.
And there is something about that and American Pimp that are quite similar. Look at O-Doctor.
Yeah. All right, O-Doctor, what's going on?
First of all, this isn't O-Doctor. I'm incognito. I did see in the chat room that somebody wanted O-Doctor to be in the film so I could advocate for that brother. He is a real dude. Everybody loves a chubby dude in a movie. Maybe we could work that out somehow. I'm just saying, maybe he could start a GoFundMe to fund the fund.
People are like, bring in O-Doctor. Bring in O-Doctor. This is why we have to get the important plugs out for everybody to go to prisonlogic.com before O-Doctor comes on, because he's going to come on and he's going to do a hilarious character and bit and totally hijack the entire episode. So we are happy to have him on now, but that's why we have to get the plugs out first.
I wanted to come on when Romany was like tearing up a little bit, because I'm going to tell y'all something about Romany Malco. I've been friends with Romany for like at least 6 years. We met at a conference. But this is a dude to like actor, whatever. This fool sends me text messages that are 8 days long. Like, we get into some conversations. I'm thinking, he's a busy dude. He ain't going to answer me back. He sends me back novels in the middle of the night. It'd be 2:00 in the morning, and I'm reading these novels. I'm like, nigga, you ain't got no job, brother. I appreciate the knowledge, but okay. And today, people think I've not contributed yet to Prison Logic, but I will, and I'll tell you exactly why. I'm watching it. I want to push it over the threshold when it comes to end. But I post every post that I see of his, and I have my daughter watch a very poignant video he made today. It was 20 minutes long, and at the end of it, she looked at me and she said, "Wow, that guy seems smarter than you." And that was when I said, "You can't watch no more of Romany's videos."
By the way,
because normally. I'm the smart one. I'm the cool one.
I think,
but not after that video.
I think that might be my favorite part of Tijuana Jackson, is that at any point in the entire movie, at any point on any Vine or Instagram or as a 3-minute long Periscope or whatever, he can just drop serious science about getting ahead in life. And it's real science. I mean, it's freaking amazing.
This was video he made about racism, and it was Romany. But it was Romany putting out content to push for TJ too. But it was just it was factual. He even asked for fact checkers in the video. It was just so on point, so poignant, and it was just spitfire. And she was blown away by it. She was like, "Wow, he's talking so fast." And every time it was something to hit home, she just got it. And I'm like, "Man, I got to show this to all the kids so they can learn a little something from Uncle Romany." And I'm just saying, if you got a dime, if you got a dollar, if you ever never contributed to anything, this is something to contribute to. One, so we can see it. Two, because the doctor might be in it. If you put him doctor in it. Apparently, it'd be real. If you get the man, you get the brother down. I mean, hook it up. I mean, do what you do. You know what I'm saying? TJ, keep it real in these streets. I'm just saying. You saw Vice. They wear this in Vice, right? They keep it real in the streets on Vice. I'm just saying.
All right. All right. Kill it. Kill it. Ladies and gentlemen, incognito. Totally different person from Owen J.J. Stone, a.k.a. O-Doctor.
Love you guys.
Let me just say, man, for real, like, O-Doctor is so weird, man. O-Doctor is like that two-sentence sensei. Like, I'll be saying I want to do something, and he'll just show up, almost like a genie. And then he'll just drop some knowledge and vanish. You're like,
dude, that's one of the things. Romany, I hesitate to say this because it'll sound judgmental of Hollywood in general, or maybe that's what you want. We've met a few Hollywood types. I don't think I've ever met anyone with the possible exception of Greg Grunberg, but he works very hard in a very different way. You have made yourself available always. Like you give out a real phone number and then you actually respond. And then you do live streams and much like a stand-up comedian would refine an act for, you know, small midnight audiences who are hanging around in a local comedy club for maybe 30 or 40 people. Like, you did the hard work performing for, you know, 50 people in a live stream on Twitch or Justin.tv back in the day. It's extraordinary. Like seeing your effort and dedication and how you don't mind putting in the hard work to make stuff happen. It's been really, really great. And I can't say enough how excited I am to see all of this culminate in I don't know, the celebratory lap that's going to come at I don't want to say the end, but at the culmination, the best Tijuana Jackson has ever been is what it looks like this is going to be.
Thank you, man. Yeah, really appreciate that, dude. Thank you. I tell you know, first of all, that's very flattering and real talk, man. These three people on the screen right here have been so incredibly helpful, insightful, and supportive of everything TJ. I got pictures with me and old doctor at this conference that he's talking about, clowning on their, you know, what color carpet do you have at this event? We are like, and it's not just that, it's just literally, you know, old doctor has called me when I was starting the thing and he brought, you know, I was starting the TJ show and he was explaining how to distribute it, how to handle, just all useful advice. We've just talked about all different kinds of things. You know, I don't know if you guys know this about this brother, but you know, he has had some very challenging situations in his family and he has just, like cream, has risen to the top and has been there for the people in his family and for his daughter in ways that, you know, you can't even begin to imagine, because most of us, you know, honestly speaking, most of us we're not forced to deal with that level of adversity. And so to have this brother on this camera, as brilliant as he is, smiling and supportive as he constantly is, you know, that in itself deserves one.
Oh, there it is.
Oh, there we go.
Standing belly clap.
Now, all right. What you were saying, Brian, back to what you were saying. I want to let you know something. I genuinely
see, and y'all this. Thought I was not here with it. I got my clap. I think I'm one up on Brian right now, so I'm definitely with it.
I don't know. Who's keeping track? Who's keeping track? But it might be.
I'm ahead of Brian. I'm not last now. I'm in fourth place. I'll take the chat realm, and Jerry got first. Romney got third. I'm coming fourth. Brian's a fifth. Happy. Oh,
it's fine.
Two things real quick. One, that conference we were at, every time he walked away, he was smoking in the building, and people had to keep telling him to put the cigarette out. And as TJ, he's like, oh, man, my bad. I didn't even know he was letting him smoke. I didn't smoke. And he'd walk away, and they're like, who the fuck is that? Like, they were just blown away. Like, why is this guy keep smoking? He was not bringing character. And it's all tech people and, you know, nerds. They're just blown away by the way he's talking. And he just walk around smoking this cigarette in 93 Y Center. It's like a concert hall in New York. And secondly, Romney's being over nice, because I was supposed to meet up with Romney. We were supposed to have dinner, and I got sidetracked with a real major family issue, and I sent one of my favorite liaisons and a beautiful woman to go have dinner with Romney in my place. And it's one of the worst situations my dad got. I missed the time to hang out with my brother, but he graciously took them out, and they bought out on the streets without me. I still cry about it every once in a while.
All right. Listen, hey, Justin, you know, Diamond Time is the time that we get to shout out the projects of not just famous, highfalutin, super talented, down-to-earth, really cool, hardworking Hollywood types.
Yeah.
But also the projects of Chat Realm.
Absolutely, Brian. Of course, if you go to reddit.com/r/diamondclub or diamondclub.reddit.com, you can go to the sticky post at the top of the subreddit every single month and make sure that you get your project shouted out. Let's start with Lestija83. Hello, Night Attack. My boyfriend and I watch, listen, and read everything that you guys do. Recently, I became a fifth grade teacher here in Austin, Texas.
What?
And I started a project on donorschoose.org to help my students interact and make connections with science and technology. My students come from the lowest socioeconomic demographic in the district, and many cannot afford internet, let alone a computer. Computer skills are part of the Texas curriculum, but resources are focused mainly on paper-based textbooks. I am determined that my students will learn how to find useful information, create documents, and read textbooks online by the end of the year. To that end, we need a class set of tablets for our classroom. The computers we have are missing screens, will not turn on, or have missing keyboards, and the school is not in a position to fix or replace them, as many of them are too old to claim for warranty. My goal for this project is to put reliable working tablets in the hands of every student in my classroom and then create a website that highlights the work we do online. Already, some of my students have created mystery stories, biography slideshows, one on a former WWE champion Dean Ambrose, and are currently working on comic strips about books that they are reading using makebelievecomics.com. However, not all my students can participate due to the lack of resources. Please help us discover the utility and possibility of online exploration by donating to our project. If you'd like to donate a few dollars to help my students become technology literate by helping us obtain a class set of Android tablets, please go to, let's see if California Carl came up with a shorter one, tinyurl.com/fifthgraderules. Again, tinyurl.com/fifthgraderules. Any amount that you can kick in is greatly appreciated. The next phase of my project will be to begin a photo diary of their science project using the tablets. That way they can log their progress and begin learning how to collaborate using technology. Until then, I'd love to submit photos of their amazing projects for all the world to see. Great, great, great cause.
Go ahead, Romany.
So I spelled fifth grade rules and it didn't come up.
tinyurl.com/5thgraderules.
In the meantime, $1 William writes with the headline, join in. Diamond Club Project Month is coming. Mark your calendars for October 1st. Declare things with capital letters and exclamation points. Diamond Club Project Month will be a month-long program in October for the Diamond Club community members to take a break from being entertained and create something. Finish up those projects you've been too busy for. Start work on that idea you've been too afraid to get into. Embrace creation over consumption, at least in October. Post updates to the Reddit with the tag DCPM, and Brian and Justin may check in on them during Night Attack. For more information, check out the post and /r/Diamond Club or hit the link yellow420.com/DCPM. And he gives the proviso, except for the fine programs of diamondclub.tv, of course.
This is a great thing, and you're going to hear a lot more about it because I am very committed to this. I'm going to make a project, and I think that the best thing about this community is, you know, hey, listen, this is a great episode to highlight it. You've got four people on this show of different, you know, ways of life, different places physically, different economic brackets that are all just getting stuff done and have made their lives better based on what Romany so eloquently called self-creation, self-starting. This is a great way that we can nurture that, and this will be our own NaNoWriMo. Got it now. In the meantime, let's go ahead and read our final Diamond Time submission.
All right.
Hi, Attackers of the Night. I'm a longtime listener to Night Attack and Weird Things. Okay, now listen. Narthax wrote this, and it is a serious thing. However, I'm just going to let everybody know. If you go past two paragraphs, I'm going to start editing them.
Yep.
All right?
Yep.
I know that these are serious. I know that they deserve all the words possible. I'm just saying, you got to give me something that I can read in under 10 minutes.
Yep.
So here's the deal. Narthax has been using Kratom for over a year due to a shoulder injury that left him in constant pain. He's been in and out of physical therapy as far as he can afford. And in the meantime, he's frequently been prescribed narcotic painkillers that have left him debilitated to the point that it started interfering with his ability to work. He discovered Kratom a few months into his treatment. The difference between it and opiate painkillers is outstanding. Kratom is not addictive, effective, and makes him feel, quote unquote, high.
No, it doesn't.
Make him feel high to the point where he can't function. So here's the real boner. The DEA has announced that it has plans to abuse its regulatory powers to make this plant illegal. Without going into the details, the DEA announced that it is criticized for cherry-picking its data, abusing their emergency scheduling powers, and refusing to allow public and expert input into the ban before announcing it. Many people have been using this herbal medicine to treat far more serious conditions than he has, and many have even used it to curb opiate addictions and to get off heroin. Kratom does not produce anything more than what can be described as an extremely mild high, quote-unquote, comparable to psychoactives of coffee, but the DEA has decided that this is unacceptable. There's a petition on whitehouse.gov that has already surpassed the 100K baseline to require a response from the Obama administration, but I want to place it here because every additional signature helps show the support that the Kratom community has. To link the petition, it can be found at yolo420.com/TUM swag. That is yolo420.com/TUMSWAG.
This is not for nothing, but if you type in Kratom, K-R-A-T-O-M.
Yeah.
Number one result is a Narconon link. And for those who don't know, Narconon is allegedly Scientology.
Not interesting. Narcotics Anonymous?
That's Scientology. Narconon, as I understand it. I don't know. Somebody correct me. I'm sure I'm wrong. Okay. But yeah. So there's that.
What is that supposed to mean?
I'm sorry, I typed in Kratom. I wanted to know what was up, and the first link on Google, like the SEO, heavily favored Narconon. Narconon, I happen to know from you know, reading up on Scientology, is a Scientology organization.
It's a Scientology thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And the same way that Alcoholics Anonymous is a Christian religious organization.
Sure, sure. Yeah. But it was just a little surprising to me that they own the number one spot. What's up, Bon?
Did you say, just to be clear? And then
yes. Just to be clear, what I mean by that is I'm actually OT3, and I can go clear if I say that. So now I'm clear.
Okay.
Congratulations.
Thanks. All right. Just checking in.
Okay. So there we go. Diamond time.
Sorry
course.
For screwing up the show, people.
Well, I just didn't know where that was even going.
It was like, not going anywhere.
Hey, by the way, just to pump the brakes on the show, I saw a thing, and I would like to remind everybody that it's another thing.
What is it? Well, thanks for being on the show, Romany.
Wait a minute. I'm sorry. You know what? I felt like Brian was making a point, but I got a little distracted because what happened was you did the search, and somehow it came up affiliated with Scientology.
Yes.
Right?
Yes. So when you type in Kratom.
Kratom,
Kratom. The very first, the top SEO, basically the Boardwalk and Park Place of SEO, the game, happens to be owned. Like, it's as though I'm running around Monopoly Land, and I notice that the Boardwalk and Park Place happens to be owned by Player Scientology. To which I say, oh, hey, here's an observation. Scientology owns these spots. And then all the other players threw dice at me.
Well, I didn't even know. Like, I didn't know whether that was a good thing or a bad thing. Also, I didn't know whether or not the page was like criticizing Kratom.
I'm bankrupt. I'm out. I'm gonna take my.
He doesn't want to offend anyone with that shit. So, because he started pulling punches. Because what he was kind of saying was he was kind of like taking the effects of Kratom, right? And the possibilities of like what the effect might have, the drug side effects of the drug might have, and making an association to other forms of stimulation that may come from placebo religion, you know, right?
Not doing any of this. In fact, what I'm doing right now is shutting the hell up. How about that?
Yo, I did a search for group one drug Kratom.
Sure. Yeah.
And a page comes up and it's like five things you need to know, five facts you need to know about Kratom. And the first one is like, those in possession of kratom could face the same penalties as those as posing heroin, as heroin, yeah, or whatever. And then the second fact was is that the DEA is citing it as poison control as a reason to ban the plant. And that's really interesting to me because I take something that I just mix on my own, which is borax. You know what that is?
No. Go on.
Yeah, borax is
it his, you know, my wife.
My wife. You know, no, but borax is like, it's like.
Oh, borax. Like a mule team borax.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. 20 mule team.
Salt, but. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. It's like sodium borate. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's just like a compound or some, you know, that you know, salt mineral or whatever. And, you know, you dilute it with a lot of water and it's really good for like helping to create an equilibrium in your body and balance out your candida. But it also helps to detoxify you and it helps you to absorb water and nutrients better. But that also for a long time was regarded a poison. And the reason is because it was discovered that borax was actually an incredibly effective cure for arthritis.
What?
Yep. And so Australia and all these different countries throughout Europe lifted the ban like this is bogus. You know, this, you know, you can't rate this thing as a poison when it's actually quite benign and harmless. And so anyway, I automatically become suspect when I see, you know, drugs, particularly drugs like these, you know, becoming
Well, listen, I mean, I know I've heard about kratom through other stuff. I'm going to be totally honest, man. I don't know shit about ass when it comes to kratom. Like, I have not tried it myself. I do not know it. All I know is like, wait, we're still making drugs illegal? Like, I thought we were rolling the other way now. I thought that boulder was on the other side of the hill where we're making drugs not legal. Oh, okay. All right. That's fine. I guess I didn't know we were still doing that. It bro. Seems quaint.
Definitely got to check out Romany's video on that. He'll tell you all about the drug wars in about 8 minutes. He'll score you real quick.
I'm going to keep my mouth shut because the one thing I don't want to do, Big Pharma, somebody said it for me, Big Pharma, there's so, I'm just be quiet.
That's why you wear this, Romany. That's why you got to wear this, baby.
Romany, we're this close. We're this close to nailing it, man. Everybody go to prisonlogic.com. Make sure to support this project.
Oh, wait a minute.
What?
Chat realm. Really quick though, bros. I got to ask y'all this question.
Yeah.
If you wanted to see a perk on that site, what would the perk be? Straight up.
I mean,
I don't listen. They were down there complaining that some of the perks that they wanted were already gone. So even if it was just freeing up a few more.
Dude,
tell me.
There's one thing I want. You set some number and we'll rally the troops to try to just make a diamond appear in the credits. Just all by itself. No explanation, no nothing. We'll all know that we did it together. Come up with some, in fact, like come up, you know what? How about this? Donate any prime number. This is what an asshole I am. Donate any prime number and you will be part of the Diamond Brigade, right? And then that way you could donate $7. You can donate 723, I think, is a prime number. Whatever. I mean, whatever you want, whatever level you want. If you donate a prime number, you're part of this.
Okay.
Although, also, like you want to make Romany go search through every prime number that comes in?
No, actually, that's just it. He doesn't ever have to look because everyone who donates a prime number will see that diamond and go, "I did that." Like, it doesn't matter. I mean, how's he gonna check on that?
Yo, everybody's pissed off because they already donated. Damn.
Mm.
I really should have said that earlier.
Well, they just have to up. They just have to up their pledge to the next number. Is all.
Damn.
Man, that's what happens when the kratom starts talking to you.
Oh, dude, you guys.
The Scientology math kicks in.
Get more open on the show, and then the next thing you know, it's like I'm in alpha state now. I'm like thinking of. You know, but no, listen. Still, what perks can I put on this? I need help. Come on. And I'm thinking like I could make, I tell you what, I'll go make a Diamond Club perk right now while we're talking.
Oh, shoot. All right, now we got to do something good.
And I'm not going to make it, you know, crazy expensive, but it's just basically, it's going to be the Thank You Diamond Club.
There we go.
What do you say?
Go and I'll give you money. I was going to give you money anyway.
He's asking us. We have to come up with what that amount is and what the what to do.
Well, what it'll be is it'll be a section of the thing, and it'll just be an acknowledgement of the Diamond Club, and all the people who've made that perk, their name will appear.
Oh!
You get what I'm saying?
Yep.
Absolutely. So that goes by. This it's a special thanks to
$17 76 cents. $17.76.
$17.76. Wait a minute.
Is that too low?
No, that's awesome.
Okay. I didn't know if I had offended. That's something everybody could do. We could all donate $17.76 and
for the
it'll
uninitiated,
come in.
It's an Alex Jones reference.
That's fine.
It is a reference to Romany. You ever seen the guy Alex Jones, the radio host Alex Jones?
Yeah, I totally know who's Alex Jones. Yeah. You know, he's the guy that went on Piers Morgan and actually went hardcore. You know, it's funny. I used to watch him before that. And then after that.
Yep. So here's the deal. So we also, number one, by the way, that dude, number one, there is one person in this quadrant that has been in studio with Alex Jones, a guest on his show. Oh, I wonder who it is. I wonder if the Incognito's here.
It may or may not. The FBI, the CIA. I signed a non-disclosure agreement. I'm just saying. How y'all trying to set a brother up, man? Come on, man.
I'm trying to get my Alex Jones impersonation on, but I don't think I got it right now. Let me hear his voice real quick. Give me a second.
Okay, hold on. I gotta hear
his voice.
This is a recording of Alex Jones' voice.
1776 will commence again if you take our guns from us. This is
Alex.
Righteous
Alex.
Liberty.
Alex.
He's charging
Alex.
Into a goblin's
Alex.
Nest, goblin vomit, not having been bad with a goblin.
Alex, I'm telling Alex, here
That's
in America.
That's not a bad pierce. That's not a bad pierce either.
Pierce.
Yeah. All right, Alex.
Understand.
Alex. Keep going. Keep going. Better. You got this.
This is brilliant.
Okay, let me hear.
My God, you have got a total police state. Everybody's fleeing that country because you've had to flee here, bud. Why don't you tell folks? Yeah, you fled here.
I did.
Why don't you go back and face the charges for the hacking scandal?
Answer this question. How
Alex,
many
go back and
why don't you get
charges
fired from the Daily
how
Mirror for putting
many,
out fake stories?
How
you're a hatchet
many,
man of the New World
hatchet.
Order.
You're not a real journalist.
I'm
going
to say this right here. You think you're
I'm
a tough guy?
Right here. Okay.
All right, stop. The show's going to be another hour long if we keep on going. Yes, do me a favor. I am right now going to donate $1776. Okay.
Let him create the thing and we'll all go charge it.
Okay, so this is going to be, just to be clear, it's going to say extra special thanks to Pop.
Just the logo.
Boom.
Okay. Just the logo, yeah.
Just the logo. And then we could, I tell you what, how many of these should I make available?
Oh, geez. I don't know. How much money do you want?
How much money do you want, bro?
Yo, okay. I'm creating a damn perk.
I would say only do 100.
7.76.
Yes!
Oh, this thing won't.
I remember back in 1776 when you couldn't even donate to a brother's website.
That's what I was thinking. I was like, he got his thing down.
I know.
That's what I was thinking. I'm like 1776 as in the year. Guys, it won't let me do 1776.
Oh, really? It's got to be a solid number.
$1,776. I'm going to do $1,776. It's the same thing.
Same thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Same thing.
So what do I do?
Man.
Let's just do 18, but we'll all know it in our hearts.
Yeah, you know what? Yeah, can you do that?
Yes. Extra special.
I can't believe like two people in the chat are trying to round it down. 17? No, we're going to go to 18.
But you said prime numbers.
Listen, before you donate, please make sure that I did this shit right. Somebody, just send me Diamond Club, because I've got it like this right now, right?
Don't forget,
I've got it like this
you got
right
to touch, you got to touch your pads. Yeah.
But I've got the two little whatever those things are called going like this right
now.
Yeah,
the brackets. Brackets. Yeah,
there
you go.
You've got it right.
Yeah,
you got it.
But there should be a space in between them, no?
No, it doesn't need a space
no,
between it.
No, it's fine.
Okay, cool.
It's all
special thanks.
Good.
Okay, now what am I going to do? This gives every member, every contributor, every Diamond Club contributor.
There you go.
There we go.
So we have to know. That's the secret thing, right? Only accept it if somebody gives you the you got to in the notes, because I'm sure there's some kind of feedback or whatever we give. You throw that Diamond Club symbol in there.
No, but here's what's the deal. Here's what's really funny about this is that I'm making it a secret perk. So when I send you the link, only we get it.
Oh,
get
good. All right, go. Oh, let's do
perfect,
this.
Perfect.
Yeah, okay. No, that's ideal.
Okay, cool. So bear with me.
No, and that's fine. I'll tell you what. In the meantime, Romany, you handle that. Let's go to Incognito. ONJJ Stone, a.k.a. O'Doctor. What can you, what would you like us to gaze our eyes upon?
Yeah.
Oh, I just did a new Doc Tales with Nina Hartley, porn star extravaguer, first woman I ever watched porn with. We had an hour together, and it was special. So we talked about everything. It's all sexual. It's NFW. But me and Nina Hartley got to talking, boy. It was great.
Wow.
It's on my Twitter. It's on IQMZ.com. You can go check it out. It's under Doc Tales. Yeah, me and Nina, boy. Oh, and she was naked when we started the interview. She's like, do you do video? And I'm like, yeah. So she ran to put a shirt on. But then midway through the interview, she gets up to get a book, and you see her butt. She's naked running. I kind of had to
she only
that
put
out.
On. She only put on a shirt?
Yeah, she only put on a shirt. So she runs to the bookshelf behind her, and her butt's a little jiggling. And so I had to, like, edit that out because of YouTube. But if you hit me up, if you DM me, Or Patreon me or something, I'll send you the full video of her butt shaking. She don't
finally,
mind.
Finally, she we can mind. See Nina Hartley's naked butt.
I mean, yeah. You can see it on the internet for free, but you can see it through my eyes if
got
you
it.
Want. You just
got
email
it, got
me.
It.
I said it.
Okay, but is the body still tight? Because I'm going to tell you, she had like a legit, you know, I just got to be she was stacked up. She was very thicked up. You know what I mean? That she still, is
dude,
it still looking tight?
I got my invite out to California, and I got the personal phone number and everything. I'm just saying, it's still right on target, my brother.
Dude.
Best I'm ass in the business.
By the way, O'Doctor's look right now looks like the Pete Best of Goody Mob.
Oh. Dude, you know what? That's kind of funny. Do you see it?
Well,
you know,
I'm trying to show all my roles.
Like he was the dude that was in Goody Mob.
I'm trying to show TJ my
rank. But before Soul Food hit, like, you know, he left the group right before Soul Food.
Dude, I've got it here. This gives every Diamond Club contributor a special thanks in the end credits. Your name will be listed amongst the greats.
All right, there we go.
So all right, so just, we need that in the chat room. How are we gonna get that?
Here, if you can send me that in Skype. We'll make a bit.ly for so that everybody can get to it afterwards.
But I'm stuck. I got a couple questions really quick. I just want to know, like, I'm dead ass serious. This is gonna sound so terrible, but when you talk to someone like Nina Hartley, right? Back when I was watching porn, you know, and it's been a while. I ain't gonna front. You know, it would seem like some of these girls were like literally going through some emotional issues. Like there was like some therapy, like they were getting, like it was, like, you know, I've seen women crying in porn, you know, shit make a brother a little uncomfortable. Did you ever talk? Cause she's, I saw her once on something, and I could see that she was very vocal and very much, you know, an advocate for strong women and all this other stuff. But she's the kind of person that seems qualified to answer a question like that. Are there instances where people have gotten into porn and realized that they're not psychologically equipped to be doing it?
Owen?
I'm on the delay a little bit because I can't hear Romany through the real live channel. I've been listening to Romany through the audio.
Sure.
But listen, so I talked to her about that, and basically her thing was, she was a nurse, and she was going to school, and everything was cool, and some guy offered her some money to do a scene, and she fell in love with it because she loved sex. Now, she says that a lot of girls aren't like that. A lot of girls just in it for the money, or they're high, or they're on drugs. But for her personally, she's just a sex freak. She loves women, she loves men, and she loves the sex, and she loves what she's doing. And the basic point she brought down to me was, she's like, you got to think of porn as a cartoon. It's not real. people don't attach themselves to it. They're not usually emotionally invested. And maybe you might get a young actress or something like that that might be crying or upset or feel some sort of way. But it's an industry business, and it's not real. She described it over and over again as a cartoon, which I found very interesting. Like, I compared it to Tom and Jerry, where you just keep beating the mouse over the head, and the mouse stays alive. These girls just scream and have orgasms after 3 seconds. So we talk about that, Romney. You got to peep it. We talk about all that.
Okay, I will peep it. You know, so basically what she's saying is it's kind of like our election process.
Hey, Justin, remember when we used to have a show together? It was the two of us.
Yeah, basically. Romney, we got to do it on our. Romney, you got to get on Docktail so we can do all this. My bad.
By the way, chat room has a good point. Check out Hot Girls Wanted on Netflix if you want more of that stuff. Justin.
By the way, speaking of South Florida documentaries, there's Hot Girls Wanted.
Very much so. Dude, this has been extraordinary, Romney. Thank you so much for joining us. This is you. Are a family member of Diamond Club and Chat Realm.
And man, I wanted to say before I go, and I'm going to try to keep it as short as I can, but you know, when you were giving me credit for being in touch and in contact, it's really because I genuinely admire what you guys are doing. I've always found it revolutionary. I've always told you that. I like the idea that you guys are self-generators and you demonstrate the value of establishing your own voice, having your own voice, and being willing to come out week after week. It's hard work. People don't know what it takes to do what you guys are doing consistently. And so, you know, I don't just give up my number to any freak, and I don't take a number from just any freak. You know what I mean? You two freaks, though, I wanted your numbers because I really was inspired by you, and you are incredibly encouraging, and both of you are incredibly intelligent and ambitious. When I saw you on TV, Brian, it was like A&E or something like that.
Discovery Channel, Nat Geo.
I got my whole crew. We all sat down and squozed one out like a big circle jerk, just in celebration for fucking triumph, bro. So, anyway,
dude. All right, Nat, you're going to make me cry, so we got to wrap this thing up. Play the lullaby. But, Justin, anything left to plug?
Don't go yet. I'm sending you the link to the perk.
All right. What is it? All right, it's coming in.
Just paste it into Skype, and we'll make a bit.ly so that everybody can get their perk.
So here we go. Here it is. Tell me if you got it. I just placed it in the Skype.
Yep, we got it.
We did get it. So we're going to make bit.ly/prisondiamond. Let's try
Prison
that.
Diamond, which
I'm breaking TJ out. I ain't going back to jail. I ain't going back.
Dude, there were so many other bits in that skit that I couldn't use. Duh, it was so wrong. Anyway.
Prisondiamond.
Oh, yeah, by the way, apologize to Curtis LaRock, one of our hardest core. You know, felt a glancing blow with the Haitian joke that TJ made. How would you describe TJ's opinion on the Haitian people?
You know, I think that you know obviously TJ has a lot of love for the Haitian people. You know what I'm saying? Because he's surrounded by them. He lives in Hollywood, Florida. He kicks it with them. You know, he's dated a few. In fact, he's still in love with one named Kathleen. And so I think that
there is not a Haitian named Kathleen.
No, I want to believe
named Kathleen.
I dated a Haitian named Kathleen. What are you talking about?
I stand corrected.
And let me tell you something. Kathleen is the shit. All if you're listening, Kathleen.
I don't doubt.
But no. And so what I was saying is that I don't think that TJ's attack was necessarily on a demonstration of a disregard for Haitians. I think it was more of a reference, his mindset. It's a reference to the condition of parts of Haiti ever since the earthquake. You get what I'm saying?
Yep,
you
absolutely.
Know, it wasn't all right, guys. It wasn't as much of a racial depiction as it was about the economic condition. You know, he could have said Puerto Rican, but it just so happens that Haiter and Haitian go
Hater and Asian go hand in hand. I will say this: there is nothing but love from Tijuana Jackson
Yeah.
To the Haitian community.
Bits.
Exactly. And he also goes hard on, you know, the Mexican community. He goes hard on himself. He does. It's like he just can't help himself. I forgot what the line was. He said, I'm not going to try to recall it. I'm going to slow everything down. But, you know, please. The point of it is that TJ is heavily flawed. And you should take none of it personal. The whole joke is on TJ. That's the point, is that he's giving everyone permission to be flawed, to be opinionated, to be wrong, and shows you that life goes on and it is okay. This concept of like not being able to genuinely express yourself for the sake of ridicule or being excluded from some particular group or some particular, you know, or not from some particular hierarchy is BS. That's not what human beings do. That's what robots do. That's not what human beings do. That's what zombies do. No, it is important to have a voice, to have a unique opinion, and to express that opinion and learn from it. You might learn. Like a voice that you have in your community might not work in my community. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But when you come into my community and you express that voice, rather than chop you down, what I actually want to do is I want to try to understand your perspective and share my perspective, and maybe we both come out of it with an elixir that we can take back to our perspective communities. You get what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
That's what it is. And I've traveled and lived in so many friggin' places in search of elixirs, and I stand by that damn comment.
Nope. You're right. You're right.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I'll tell you what. A man of many elixirs, ladies and gentlemen. His name is Romany Malco. His project is the Prison Logic movie, the story of Tijuana Jackson. You can go to get our official perk. He made it for us live and direct. That is bit.ly/prisondiamond. Just go ahead and get that $18 perk. I would love to see so many of these. He put 50 out there. I'm curious to see how many of those 50
they're going to be gone in no time. Gone in no time. Also, somebody did YOLO420.com/prison swag. Romany Malco, thank you so very, very much for hanging out with us.
No, thank you guys for having me. I love y'all. Yo, Doctor, man, let's chop it up as soon as we can. Brian, Justin, when y'all get time.
Hashtag prison logic, baby.
Let's break bread.
All right, absolutely. You got it, boss.
That's it.
What was that?
It was my accent.
Who knows? Who knows?
Doesn't matter. Now, it's all right. Throw it up. No, diamonds in the sky, people. See you next Tuesday. Is there
something dying of fire. Is there something I can do? Oh, no. Night attack is done. My heart has been broken. The depression's just begun. Brian Brushwood. Every time you leave, I wanna hurt myself by pissing off some bees. I'm allergic to bees. Oh, Justin Robert Young, every time you go, I get so sad that I wanna drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack.
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 I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.